Hello, everybody. Hello, masters of your own destiny. Yes, I have a smile from ear to ear because I'm in my basement. I'm here as a kid in a candy store. Oh, my God. Every time that I come here to record a new episode from Suarez's basement, I'm full of energy and love and care because I really want to be sure that we produce a very good quality episode where we can create bridges between those experts in the communication, media, and the arts, and you, our audience. And talking about experts, our guest today, I think we just knock it out of the park, home run all the way out. We are talking with the head of creative production for Shondaland Netflix. Tom Verica is in the house. He's not only the person that is behind every single detail of some of Netflix's hit TV shows like Bridgerton, Inventing Anna, Queen Charlotte, but he also is a very talented actor, TV director, executive producer. I mean, you name it. Well, he have done everything in the book. So talking about having an expert, Tom Verica is in the basement. I cannot wait. But if you go there, I need to thank WCNY, PBS in Central New York, and Central New York are for their partnership. It's thanks to these two nonprofit organizations that we can come to you every other week. So thank you again for the trust. And remember, if you want to visit our home, is fsbasement.com. Very simple, fsbasement.com. You're going to have access to the entire library of past episodes in audio and in video. And you're going to find a bunch of amazing experts that have been working in some of your favorite TV shows and movies and theaters and plays. You name it, they are all there. Thank you for tuning in. And let's start this new episode from Suarez Basement with Tom Verica right away. Here we go. Tom, I want to welcome you to my basement. Thank you so much for taking the time to be with me today.
Thank you, Francisco. I appreciate it. I'm happy to be here.
Tom, you are head of creative production for what is called Shondaland and Netflix.
That's correct.
I want to start with a very simple question. No, that is simple, but explain to us, to the viewers and to the listeners, what it means to be head of creative production for such a large company. What is your everyday decisions that you need to take and things like that?
This particular position was created once Shonda moved to Netflix, part of her overall deal. It because of the size of the company and the shows that were coming in and part of her deal, she created this position for me, being an actor, director, and producer, primarily a director at this point, to kind of oversee and advise all aspects of the creative parts of production. Now, that can be anything from pre-production, getting ready, you know, where we're going to film, what are the locations, we're selecting the directors, casting, selecting the actors, post-production, you know, also in production, what we're doing in production. So the day-to-day of when we're filming, if I'm not directing, I'm going over the schedule, making sure everything is kind of in place. We have a lot of people, heads of departments, but I just oversee creatively to make sure there's a story we want is being told in the way that we want them. Now that's visually, that's emotionally with the actors. Those all happen during the time of production, and then in post-production it's, you know, working on the edits, editing a lot of the episodes, getting it down, honing in the story, working with the visual effects department, with music, with the composer for the music. So it's really any given day, depending upon which project we have, which we have numerous ones, I kind of go where I'm needed the most. So the areas of which either there's, you know, if it's a big location where we're doing one of our dance balls for Bridgerton, there's a lot going on there. So I'll probably put most of my efforts into a day like that. So it's really wherever I'm needed is kind of, and then I when I'm directing, it's solely just about directing because that takes up all my brain.
So in other words, anything go wrong is your fault.
No. Well, yes. I mean, you know what? Depending upon who you ask, some people will say, he told me
to do yes. that. Wow, that is incredible. That's a lot of work. It's unbelievable, the amount of work. Listen, I like always to go back in time and give my guests the opportunity to go back to their childhood, because a lot of our listeners and our viewers, they never identify with you, right? Meaning like, oh, right. Wow, I have this head of production and he's doing these amazing scenes. And we always feel like, how I get there, how I start there. Tell me a little bit about your childhood and when do you realize, oh my God, acting is something that I want to do and something that I want to be more or less involved in visual storytelling. When was that time in your childhood?
That moment happened for me. I remember distinctly when it was. I think it's been all throughout my childhood and I didn't realize it. I think in my later years, once I was in the business for a while, I had the kind of the light bulb go off saying, oh, I was always this. I always wanted this. I just didn't realize it until this point. I went after high school, where I grew up outside of Philadelphia. I knew nobody in the industry. I was kind of interested in getting into, I was attracted to acting and wanted to maybe try school plays, but I played a lot of sports and those two clubs don't mix. So I stayed with the sports because that's what I had been playing all along leading up to that point. And I went away to college for business, and I studied to get a business degree. And halfway through that first year at college, I realized this is not what I want. I don't want to do 4 years of college for something that I'm just not driven by. And I remember sitting down with my parents and springing on them. My father just asked me point blank, what do you want to do? If you could do anything, you know, you have to, in life, you have to follow what it is you want to do. So you have no regrets. You can change a year. You can change 5 years from now. He said, what do you want to do right now? If you could really decide what direction you want to go in life, what would you like to do? And I said, well, I always thought about trying acting. And he didn't flinch. He supported me, helped me sort of find, you know, getting into Philadelphia, some of the programs, the acting schools of which I started getting into. And then I started doing local theater in Philadelphia. And that kind of really got my feet wet. And, you know, 2 years later after that, I decided to go full on and make it a career and moved to New York and studied with a very reputable acting teacher for a 2-year program, and that I immersed myself. Once I kind of did that, that was it.
What is it about acting that you love? What is there?
Yeah, I think it was really kind of getting into the mind of a different role, creating a character based on experiences, either experiences that I knew that I may have had some sort of interest in, but it was really, I was drawn to the fact of immersing myself into the mindset of a person in a different walk of life. And that varied whether, you know, they early on it was police, you know, it was police officers, it was lawyers, it was doctors, you know, all the stuff that there was a lot of casting for. But it was really, I was drawn to the mechanics and the makeup of what makes people tick and what they do and my interpretation of that and what I can bring to it. Mm. And then once I got into acting class and really kind of tried and played a lot of different roles, I think that's what really clicked, saying this feels right and this feels like a fit for me. I really enjoy and get I really get a lot out of this exercise.
And I can imagine the respect that the actors where you direct as you know, you are a director. We're going to talk about also your directing career, which is fascinating, but you know, to be able to have that experience allow you to really have this connection with the actors that you are directing, because you have been in their shoes, right? So that's
yeah, and I think when I walk onto a set as a director, I do, to your point, I kind of have a pass. You know, I think they know that I'm an actor, so I'm going to speak their language, or I'm going to certainly understand where they're coming from. And I do. I I'm able to switch because a director brain and an actor brain are very different. As a director, oftentimes it's I'm dealing with a lot of the crew. Most of it's technical, whether it's I'm dealing with the director of photography or all the numerous departments that I have to deal with on a crew. But as soon as I go in after we cut a take or I'm giving notes to the actors, it's completely about story and character at that point. And my brain is completely focused on that, making sure that that authenticity is coming through. And the actors know that. They feel that. I speak in kind of that approach about, you know, really exploring these moments and getting the most out of it.
Mm-hmm. And it seems to me you're doing the homework in the sense that, you know, I have students that came to me and say, well, you know, I have 2 weeks working in this production company. They want to be a director, right? But it's a lot of work. So I think I'm going to change and say, listen, more than you build yourself from the ground zero, when you get to that point to be a director, if that's what she wants to be, you're going to have the respect of the entire crew because you know what it means to be in that, you know, lawyer aspect of the pyramid, and you're going up, right?
Well, they can only inform you. The more knowledge you have, the better filmmaker it makes you. So whether it's working in the sound department or visual effects or editing, post-production, you're going to there's going to be some element to that experience that are going to be tools in your toolbox. Mm-hmm. So the more you can explore that while you're sort of on your trajectory, you know, don't put something off that can really benefit from your fully realized abilities as a director. The more you have, the more ability you have to talk to certain departments, the better director you're going to be.
Mm-hmm. And Tom, listen, I'm a professor, like, you know, I'm an associate professor at SUNY Oswego, which is SUNY is the State University of New York, right? And I teach scriptwriting, which is probably my most favorite class. I teach scriptwriting for television. And, you know, I talk to my students not only that they're living in the second golden era of television, based on the fact that stream media have opened all these doors to new possibilities, but the question that they have, especially when I have a student who I recognize the talent and the good writing and the good storytelling, how, in your own experience, how I break the wall? How has a student who's a future writer can actually say, okay, I would like to pitch my story, or I would like somebody to read my script? In your opinion and experience, what is the best way for this new generation to get to that point where maybe they will be in front of any stream media company pitching the show?
Well, that's the $1 million question. And you know, and one that this industry does not have, as you know, and you're well aware of, a specific trajectory that guarantees if you do this, you automatically get to this level, you automatically get, ultimately it's the story. The story is everything. If your script is you know, compelling enough and authentic enough to get to the point of selling it, if you're starting from scratch and try to get it seen, you know, the ways of doing it is getting an agent on board who sees it, who could submit your material to, you know, production companies that are looking for that type of material. In festivals, you know, there's festivals like, you know, we work with Series Fest, which is in Colorado. They have pitch-a-thons and they have people come in and hear live pitches from people who enter into their festival. So they'll listen to that. You can make connections that way. Networking is really it. You find somebody, you try to get into arenas where like-minded people are trying to do the same thing. And that always begets another avenue, another door that opens up. It's very difficult just to send your thing if it's unsolicited, because a lot of people don't take unsolicited material. So that's why representation is key if you can get it. But we all know the catch 22 is nobody's going to rep you if you haven't done anything. But you know, everyone faces that. We face that as actors, as directors. You just got to keep hammering out, finding ways. If it's, you know, shooting a sample reel and putting it on social media, or getting it up that somebody, or get in front of the eyes of somebody, you just got to do whatever you can to find out who is open to that, who's looking for new material, who's open to really giving somebody a shot.
Mm-hmm. in your opinion, what we talk about, because the story, you say the story, and I say that in my class, right? It's about not only the story, but how you're going to tell the story. I say, you know, shows about drug dealers, there are 20 or 40 or 100. What is about your story that is different? What is that different that you're looking for?
Just an authenticity of the voice and how they come in. And if somebody with a writer, if they're able to, through the stage direction, show me a different spin on it that doesn't feel stereotypical, or part of your story, part of that crafting. I mean, we all craft. What is the craft you're bringing to it that gives a different slant or a different bent on it than something you've seen before? You don't want to just rehash other stuff, but if you have a, be it relationship, be it dialogue, or if you have a very visual idea about how this will separate it from everything else, put that in the stage direction so you can take the reader through that journey that makes that reader sit up and say, oh, wow, this is really interesting. And then if you have the opportunity to get in the room and talk about it, you know, I always say, put together a mood board, cut together a sequence that feels like what you want this to feel like, because people, it'll help. These are the tools that'll help somebody sort of get your idea. And then, of course, your passion behind the project. And if you're not good at selling and pitching, which is it's another talent, it's a separate talent than your ability to write, you got to hone those skills or find avenues in which to sort of articulate what it is that gives it that specialness. So there's no one thing. It's really the authenticity of that voice and how you are walking the reader through that, or the person who's listening to your pitch.
Mm-hmm. Bridgerton is in a different category. What do you think is those ingredients that are in this show that suddenly it's becoming this phenomenon, right? I mean, it's from TikTok filters to t-shirts to what is in Bridgerton that is so special?
Well, I think, again, you look for, when you set out for those things, you have no idea what the impact's going to be in the long term. All these things you're talking about, those are the byproduct of something that hit or that struck a chord or that feels new and fresh. What we set out, and we never know, because we get into projects that we think are really interesting, and you never know whether the audience is going to bite on it or not. I think what struck with Bridgerton specifically were the books that were out there, which has a pretty large fan base of the books. So you have interest right there, which is one built-in thing. You then have the female audience, which is not often looked at for TV series and limited series, or not at least geared towards that audience. So you have that, and then I think it's the Shonda Rhimes. I think that's a big key that brings the eyeballs to the project, and it's really her vision, her decision to sort of option these books and get them, and her kind of idea what she wanted in this world to kind of reimagine this, the world of, you know, what would have been Pride and Prejudice and the Merchant Ivory films that were all a very particular brand, but by making this more inclusive and making it more accessible so that representation is kind of dovetailed in with this period and making it also a bit more contemporary makes it that much more accessible. So it's a risk, it's a gamble, one that clearly paid off, but it was really what she, I think, you know, Hamilton kind of shattered a lot of these doors as to what people's ideas or thinking about what it was that was seemingly, you know, in this time period, it was only white people that you were watching in the 17 and 1800s. And we really wanted to flip that. It was really about flipping that to make it something accessible to today's audience and taking elements that were historical truths. But clearly, as soon as you make a television show, it's fictionalized. And that's what people, I think, if they're on board with it, they'll go along with it. But I think by doing that and doing it successfully, it does sort of create a lot of interest in history and looking at things. So not only is there sort of a whole world to sort of dive into during this time period. But really these characters that you can kind of get lost into in these stories, which was Julia Quinn's original concept of these novels, that really struck a chord with quite a big audience, particularly in South America. I think that's where a lot of the first really big fan base kind of emerged from there. So I think with that and Shonda's sensibilities, you know, and then you do contemporary music in classical forms. You know, these are all little elements and steps along the way for an approach to telling stories this way that has clearly rung true. And you don't have any control as to whether, you know, five people watch it or 2 million mm-hmm. people watch it. Mm. It's clearly struck a chord and people love it. And we're getting to make more of it. So it's great.
And by the way, I made it to the show. Mr. Suarez is in the show. I'm like, oh, look at me.
That's right. Mr. Suarez. That's
Mr.
right.
Mr. Suarez is in the show.
Pretty risque so. Character. Yes.
Very risky. I like it. I like it. I was like, oh, look at that. I need to receive my royalty for that one.
There you go. Yes. Your ancestors.
Mr. Suarez. But watching Bridgerton and the writing, it would be quite difficult to write these dialogues because they need to sound more or less like people would talk at that time. You know what right. I mean? It could not mm-hmm. sound like, you know, you go and doesn't sound like we talk in these days. How that process works? You have to be fascinated to say, okay, this person is going to say something very simple, but we need to make it feel that is saying in that
time. Of the period.
Yes.
Yeah, there's a couple of steps to that process. The writers, and primarily we have American writers on the show, so they don't have the nuances, all the nuances that British and certainly proper British of the time. So they'll write kind of where they think it is, where they feel it would be. And then before the scripts get released, they have somebody from England who's a speech a dialect person who knows the world and knows the period, will kind of go through and highlight areas and say, this is what the correct pronunciation would say. And then Jess and our writers team will kind of go through and decide, do we want to be proper here, or does the effect of something that may be a slightly more contemporary might have more of an impact? And they'll make clear decisions as to why or why not. And switch things that, you know, that still hold the same meaning if it doesn't affect what the intention is. So then after we kind of go through and have the script as it is, we then on set on the day of filming, we have a dialect coach with us who is constantly working with the actors and listening for every little bit. And after every take, they're either correcting or, you know, some of the actors are better than others. Some of them constantly need monitoring or just refining a little bit here and there, certain words maybe that doesn't come easy to them. So we have someone whose sole job is to just listen and for all of our takes to make sure that it is being said properly and correctly at the time period.
Listen, you are a director. You have directed over 25 or more shows, different TV shows. You mm-hmm. direct a lot of the episodes in season 3 of Bridgerton. You direct the entire Queen Charlotte, which again yep. was that last scene of the last episode under the bed.
Mm-hmm.
That is pure good television. It's so yeah. clever, so beautiful, so well done. I don't think it was anybody in my house wasn't crying at that moment yeah. because what's actually quite unexpected, you know, how this will go on to end. So we just love it. What yeah. is your creative process in your mind? You receive a script, you read it, of course, and what's happened next? If you could put in a little bit of steps in your mind, what is the first thing that you do? You see visuals and say, okay, this is what I would like to do. Do you highlight the dialogues? What is the creative process in your head as a director?
The very first thing I do is try not to think about anything technical or think about locations or any of that. I just read it purely as a viewer would watch a television. I want to get lost in the story. So I really discipline myself into just following the story. what will happen inevitably as I go through that is there'll be ideas or thoughts, character decisions, character moments laying in, and I will make sure I have post it and write on a post it and pop it right there. This moment, I felt this right here. So I will kind of note each of those things from my first impression. It's very important to write down my first impressions when I read this, because inevitably I will come back to this. It'll be an exercise that I do at the end, right before I start filming the first day of filming. I will go back to that very first, these notes that I had to recall what it made me feel like in this moment. So, because you will have gone throughout your prep so many meetings and processes that get you further and further away, that really become the technical ways to execute this, that I kind of remind myself to bring. So that's the very first thing I do. And then I target usually the larger sequences or larger moments to determine, should we have rehearsal with the actors? We have two really emotional scenes. Let's get that on the schedule for rehearsals. We have a big, like Bridgerton, whether there's a stunt scene or a large ball with a lot of people, I will start kind of getting into designing that with the production designer as to where her mind is and what she envisions with this, because that's going to take a lot of work to execute the size and scope of something like that. So we'll target our kind of bigger set pieces. That becomes the next thing. You know, I don't care how pretty it is. You gotta be
for any reason, Mon, that you have to remember. I'm going to put you in the spot. Do you remember if you have a note for that scene that we were establishing about the last scene under the bed of Queen Charlotte? When you read that,
yeah, I mean, it was that turned out to be even better than I thought. I think in the script, Shonda had written that scene, and it was a beautiful scene that she had with the older king and queen under the bed. And then she had this scene, and the scene is what it was. It was just the two of them. And then at the end of that, she had kind of, and then she might want to just add in sort of flashbacks of the younger and older one. So I didn't tell her this, but I had the idea. I said, you know what? I'm going to have the younger actors who are playing these characters learn the scene. And 2 weeks ahead of time, I said, guys, I want you, I know you're not in this scene, but I want you to learn the scene. I have an idea, and I'm going to interchange and put the younger king with the older queen and vice versa, and just try something in the edit, so that, you know, as I'm getting in the mind, as she's, you know, the older queen is looking at her young king, and she's, it's all so fresh, this journey she took about seeing the man she fell in love with, and to really kind of see him as he was on that day they met, was a pretty powerful image that we had. So I was so happy with how it came out, and it came out even better than I planned. And they were really game. I think initially it was a little awkward for the older counterpart and the younger counterpart to be playing. But they went, I think, you know, by me walking them through that, they understood it and they went for it. And they were really game, and they really, really got aboard. And it caught everyone, like you. It caught me when I watched the first, when I got the first cut of it before I started working with it. It really caught me. And I was like, that's what I'm drawn to.
Tom the teenager. Fantastic.
Stand by me. Yeah, something like
Tom,
that.
Tom, I don't have words. In the name of my students, in the name of all of our listeners and viewers, to thank you for your time. They have been a delightful conversation, and I wish you only the best. You are, well, killing it. Your work is beautiful, and thank you for creating this beautiful moment for us.
Thank you, Francisco, and I commend you for doing this and creating what you do, and finding these outlets for your students to be able to look at and talk to different people, and your commitment and your passion, which is very clear. I thank you for doing what you do, and I'm very happy to join you for this discussion.